Hello and welcome to WEC Talk, the podcast series from the FIA World Endurance Championship. I'm Martin Haven. We kick off our 2021 season with a new name to sports car racing. My guest today is Kevin Magnussen. Well, first of all, I guess, Kevin, congratulations are in order. You've just become a father for the first time. So how's that been going?
Yeah, it's been good so far. She came a bit early, so it was planned for, well, my wife's due date was on Saturday, actually, this Saturday, 27th of February, but our daughter came on the 11th of January, so that was a bit earlier than we planned for, but everything was fine, and you know, I was lucky to be there for the birth. Because I was actually going to America the day, you know, the day she was born. But so, you know, just within a few hours, was able to cancel my flight.
Well, that's fantastic. As you say, you were due to be going to Daytona. So was that for the Raw or for the race itself that you were due to go out?
That was for the Raw.
Okay.
Yeah. So I was able to. I was going a few days early, but so I didn't miss anything really, which was good. So I was able to cancel my flight and stay with my wife for a few days,
which particularly when the baby comes so much earlier is a really important time as well. So so she's already made her mark in the family. So let's talk a little bit then about your voyage into sports car racing. As I said, you're new to endurance racing, but of course your dad, Jan, has been doing this for, well, nearly a quarter of a century since he left Formula One. What about Daytona? For the first time in an endurance race, you know, a couple of hour race or a 3 hour race somewhere, you know, a Monza would be a relatively gentle introduction. Was Daytona a bit of a culture shock, do you think?
It was a little bit, but then again, on the other hand, it was, you know, pretty smooth, really. I've been at many of my dad's races during his time. And, you know, as you said, he's raced in endurance racing for more than 20 years. And, you know, of course, I've been following him very closely. So I'm very, you know, comfortable with how, you know, endurance racing works, and I know, you know, that world quite well through him. So, you know, it wasn't such a big culture shock, but for sure there was still a lot of things that was new to me, like racing on a track with different categories and classes, and going through traffic and all that stuff. That was some of the stuff I've never had to deal with before, and you know, sharing the car with other drivers as well is a new thing. Just the way you work within the team and how you work on the setup and go about working on the car, it's all a bit different, but I really enjoyed it. It was a good experience.
And you got very close to having a massive first race achievement. I mean, you were very close in the battle for the lead into the final hour. And then, as inevitably happened, something changed the balance of power. Your car picked up a puncture. And so Renger van der Zande, one of your teammates, had to pit. But in terms of where the car was, I mean, Chip Ganassi Racing, obviously their IndyCar and their endurance racing, you know, history is absolutely top caliber. You've got Scott Dixon, who's been racing in sports cars probably since, I would venture, probably before you were born, actually. Never mind since you were at school. So a lot of experience there. And does that make it a lot easier to come in where you know that everything is going to be absolutely on the button and all you've got to do is show up and be yourself?
Yeah, it does. I mean, it makes it a lot easier that I, you know, it always makes it easier when you're with a good team, and you know, Chip Ganassi Racing is as you said, the record that they have in endurance racing, in IndyCar and NASCAR, you know, it's very, very good. So it's very clear that that the team is you know, top draw. And, you know, that makes it all a bit easier when, you know, I'm stepping into a new, you know, world of motorsport. And it's very, very good to have one such good teammate. But, you know, for sure, the expertise and the experience that the team has is very helpful as well. So, you know, it was tough to miss Daytona. We all thought that we were going to be able to win that race. When it looked like we were catching up to the lead car, at very high speed, we were catching like 20 seconds in that stint. You know, Renger started the stint, I think, more than 20 seconds off, and he was fighting with the lead car at the end of that stint with, of, I don't know, 12 minutes to go, I think he had that puncture. So that was a really frustrating time, and we were all super gutted. But you know, on the other hand, it was really nice to be fighting at the front again. You know, I've been in Formula One for 7 years now, and haven't been fighting at the front for, you know, very often. And this time we were actually going for the win, which was something I really missed the feeling of.
Is that part of the big appeal of racing outside of Grand Prix, that you can get into cars and positions where you can do what you want to do, which is win races?
Yeah, for sure. It's really the main reason why, you know, I didn't really try to stay in F1. I would have loved to stay in F1 if I could have found a place to fight at the front. I just didn't really see that happening. So, I decided I needed to get back to really winning races and you know, really focusing on enjoying what I do. Not that don't get me wrong, it's awesome to race in F1. The cars are fantastic, and, you know, it's a childhood dream to be racing in Formula One. But at the end of the day, if you know you can't fight for wins, you know, after 7 years, that becomes old. You know, it's hard to stay motivated, and it's hard to really enjoy it if you know that you are not going to be in contention for wins. So I felt like I needed a change. You know, the way I looked at it was, if I don't get, you know, closer to a deal with a top team, then I need to find something else in one of these other awesome races, forms of motorsport outside of Formula One, because I missed the feeling of winning and fighting for championships and pole positions and just fighting at the front. I missed it too much.
Now, the other big difference with endurance racing to almost any other form of racing is that your teammate, you know this from your dad's history, how many good friends he's had as teammates. You become, you know, one combination. And if either of you isn't working well, then the other one is there to lift you up rather than to take advantage. So that's going to be a big bonus point, presumably, of going endurance racing.
Yeah, absolutely. It's something that, you know, one of these things that is completely new to me, but I had a first taste of it in Daytona, and, you know, immediately I could feel that I was enjoying it. You know, I actually really like being able to work with my teammates properly, you know, and not sort of fighting against each other. And it can be a pretty hostile environment to be in, especially in Formula One, where, you know, you're absolute worst enemy is your teammate in so many senses. You know, you get messed up against your teammate in Formula One, mainly. You know, it's not really possible to compare across teams, you know, so the way to move forward in F1 is to beat your teammate and beat him, you know, big. So that becomes such a tough environment to be in, and actually, you know, it isn't always fun, you know, because at the end of the day, let's say in Haas, I was teammates with Roman Grosjean, and actually I really liked the guy, you know, and it was tough because we both knew that we had to absolutely kill each other to move forward in F1. And you know, on the other hand, we kind of got on quite well outside of the track and outside of the car. So, you know, it just creates this weird kind of tension and weird atmosphere, which coming to endurance racing, when, you know, the first test and the first race in Daytona I had with Ganassi, you know, I could easily feel what a change it is in the environment and kind of atmosphere in the team, being able to actually work with the drivers. And as you said, you know, if someone is struggling, you help him out. And likewise, you know, when I'm struggling, I can go and get help from Scott or Ringer, which is really cool.
So the rest of the IMSA season, okay, next up Sebring. So is that going to be you and Ringer and Scott again, a threesome in the car, or will it just be the two of you?
Yeah, it will be us three again. So we'll try and finish off the job this time.
What is it, do you think, that's going to be most interesting for you this year in terms of learning the racing, the multi-class action, or what? What do you think is going to be your biggest challenge, and where's the reward coming from?
Well, the reward is hopefully going to be winning races. And I think we'll do that. You know, we'll be winning races this year. We the goal is to win the championship. I would have loved to win Daytona. Hopefully I can come back and give that a go again. But you know, certainly we are going into Sebring trying to win it, you know, and it would be great to win well every race, but you know, certainly these big races, the Sebring, Watkins Glen, Petit Le Mans. But there's gonna be so many tracks that are, well, all of the tracks are new to me, but you know, all of the tracks, virtually all of the tracks are like, you know, bucket list tracks. You know, we're going to Laguna Seca, Watkins Glen, you know, Long Beach, Road America, Road Atlanta. You know, we've just been to Daytona and we're going to Sebring now. It's all really historic and sort of legendary tracks that I've always wanted to race at. And, you know, this year I'll get the chance and even, you know, also a chance of winning them. So that's, you know, I'm just excited about the season and excited to be able to go and try and win races again.
It's not a bad place to start, is it? It's a pretty impressive calendar. And although you say the tracks are new to you, the tracks are, but actually going to the circuits, I'm sure you've been to pretty much most of those when you were trailing around as a kid with your dad.
Correct, yeah.
How much do you remember of what it was like in, you know, in all of that kind of American paddock? Because it's a very different feeling, isn't it, from racing in Europe? You know, you did Formula Ford, you raced in Germany, you raced in British F3, you did Formula Renault 3.5 up into Formula One. It's very inward looking in the team. It's very sort of garage doors shut, particularly as you get further up the ladder. And that's the big culture change, isn't it? Racing in the States, particularly in endurance racing, is a very more relaxed and open kind of a paddock.
It is. It's a completely different kind of, a different sport almost. You know, it's very closed off in Formula One, and you know, only, you know, very few people get to enter the paddock and, you know, see the cars. There's not only like the super wealthy sponsors, you know, and partners of the teams, families of the drivers, get to actually see the cars up close. The rest, you know, have to go on the grandstand and watch from there, which is cool as well, but it's just different in America. You know, all the fans can go and virtually, you know, go and touch the cars and see them up close and watch the mechanics work on the cars and, you know, take pictures of it. And you know it's very, very different and way more open. And you know, it certainly, that's maybe a little bit of a culture shock to be in a paddock, you know, where fans can just walk straight up to you, you know, anywhere in the paddock. In F1, it was it's very controlled, and you know, you have autograph sessions and you go into these fan zones and then you meet the fans, but then you leave and go back into your motorhome, and and you can be on your own there. But you know, it's very different, and I think, you know, it's got to be more fun to be a fan in American racing than in F1, but I don't know.
And endurance racing the world over is the same. You know, world endurance will be exactly the same. Driver autograph sessions are longer and there is more paddock access, so it's a bit less frantic and there's a little bit more of a relaxed kind of relationship between the drivers, yeah, and the fans, and that's all. It's that family kind of feeling again. So it's yeah, a little bit less frantic and a bit more of a breath of fresh air. And World Endurance is somewhere that you will be heading as well, because in addition to your Cadillac DPI drive with Chip Ganassi, you have also been named as part of Peugeot's return to sports car racing. So tell us about that. First of all, I mean, where is the program? Obviously, it's been announced, but presumably with COVID and everything else, you haven't met anybody, seen anybody other than remotely by Zoom meetings or what have you.
Mm. Yeah, exactly. I mean, the post-show program kind of starts at the end of this year after my season in IMSA finishes. Then we're going to start working you know, full time on that, and we'll start testing the car and you know, working in the sim and yeah, so on. So I'm super excited about that. I think, you know, Ferrari announced their commitment to the hypercar category yesterday, and you know, we've got Porsche and we've got Toyota, and then there's all the LMDH teams, Porsche, Audi, etc. So I really think that it's going to be a super exciting era of sports cars that we're going into now, you know, I can't wait to be a part of it. I can't wait to start working with Porsche and I really get into that. I was lucky that it worked out this way, that I was able to, you know, sign my deal with Porsche, because it starts only in 22, so next year. So, you know, it's not my deal with Ganassi didn't rule that out, and my deal with Porsche didn't rule my Ganassi deal out. I was able to work at the same time, which I'm really fortunate that could happen. So yeah, really excited and can't wait to get into it. If I just imagine, you know, at Le Mans, you know, Porsche, Toyota, Ferrari, Porsche, Audi, you know, racing against each other, that's going to be awesome. And I'm sure there's going to be more joining as well. It's really exciting.
Well, you're absolutely right. I mean, guys like Chip Ganassi, does he not want to race at Le Mans? Of course he wants to race at Le Mans. Roger Penske has always said, you know, any opportunity to come back to Le Mans, he'll be right there. You know, from Jan's experience, Corvette have been racing there, you know, for decades as well. So it's still... Yeah. One of those huge races, you know, one of the biggest ones. And even within Formula One, there is now more of an understanding and appreciation, isn't there, of races like Le Mans and events like the Dakar as having this real global prestige rather than just being something that you do after F1.
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly not something that you just go and do, you know, after F1, and not even... I think it seems to be that people think that F1 drivers can just jump straight into any other category like Le Mans or you know, IMSA, IndyCar, etc., and you know, and kill everyone. That's just not how it is. You know, these are the drivers outside of F1, the top drivers, you know, like Scott Dixon, Will Power, you know, there's loads of other drivers out there, you know. The level is super, super high. And I think yeah, it's interesting to see, you know, it'd be great to see how well these guys could do in F1. Like, I've just, you know, started working with Scott Dixon and it's pretty clear that he's absolutely a top driver. You know, Ringer as well is absolutely up there. And I think, you know, they would easily do well in F1 as well. It's just, yeah, the level is super high outside of F1 as well. And I'm really, really enjoying it. And I think this, as you said, the public, I guess, perception of Le Mans is hopefully going to change in the next few years when all these big manufacturers will join, and I think it's going to be a big party at Le Mans for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, there'll be lots of Danish fans as well there. I mean, historically, it's been Britain's biggest motor race in terms of the number of fans that go, but it must be Denmark's by a massive amount. When you were growing up, when you were starting your racing career, how much back in Denmark was there an appreciation of sports car racing, or was it mostly F1s on the TV and that's what people knew?
No, sports car racing in the last 20 years has been very, very big in Denmark. Even before that, you know, in the sort of 80s and 90s, John Nielsen was racing in the Jaguar and won Le Mans, and he won Daytona, and you know, we've had some pretty good drivers from Denmark, you know, in the past, and Tom Christensen, of course, with his 9 Le Mans victories. Yeah, I think there was about 50,000 people at Le Mans during some of these years that Tom was winning. And you know, that's 1% of Denmark. That's a whole percent of the population of Denmark. You know, so imagine if 1% of England came. That would be a lot of people. So it's big.
I hadn't really thought of that, because we go there and we see the campsite and there's just a sea of tents, all of which have got Danish flags in. There's the one travel company that brings everybody almost. And you think, okay, that's a lot of people. But yeah, I didn't realize that 1% of the entire population. That's pretty impressive. So there's that to look forward to as well. New baby, a DPI deal, you've got the Peugeot deal. I mean, right now, you're living your best life. I mean, it looks like 2020 was a very, very weird year for everybody. 2021 looks like it's going to be another very memorable year for you. So what do you think is going to be the most enjoyable part, but that's really trying to divide your loyalties, isn't it? What are you looking forward to most this year?
It's hard to pick. I mean, I feel, you know, it's one of these things. After I, you know, put an end to my F1 career, you know, since then I've felt like a bit of a, you know, almost like a kid in a candy shop. It's like, there's so many awesome things out there to be able to do, and there's so many cool races and race cars that I wanna try. And of course now I'm going into quite a few years of endurance racing, which I'm gonna be, you know, absolutely enjoying to the fullest. And you know, I'm super fortunate to be with the teams that I am, and you know, gonna absolutely try and kill it this year in IMSA with Ganassi Racing, and then after that, absolutely going to try and kill it with Peugeot in the World Championship and at Le Mans. And you know, we need to win in both of those. And I'm just excited to be able to be part of all these great organizations and be able to look forward to winning again.
And hopefully once the restrictions start to ease, as it looks as though they may well do this year, there's the opportunity as well to do what you did when you were a kid with your family, which is take them racing with you as well. And that's another part of it, isn't it? It's always been what your family did. I mean, you trailed around with your dad and he wasn't even the first to go racing. So it's all part of that family experience of being a Magnussen, I guess.
Yeah, it is. I mean, we're all into racing in the Magnussen family, and you know, all of my cousins and all my siblings, and you know, my dad and my granddad and my uncles, and everyone's been racing at some point. And yeah, it's going to be great to be able to take those guys to the races as well, and you know, continue that legacy, hopefully.
My thanks to Kevin Magnussen, and thanks to you for joining us. We'll be back in a month's time with our second episode for 2021. Until then, from all of us at the World Endurance Championship, stay safe and goodbye for now.